blessedness and mortality. This was in response to the arguments made by the unbelievers that why Allah chose mortal men, like ourselves, humans. If He had chosen messengers, they would have been angels. However, this was the very natural way that Allah chose His messengers from the same species, the humans, who are able to understand the needs and motives of their own fellow members, fellow men, and therefore they can guide them in the best possible manner. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah mentions, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. For even before your time, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we never sent any prophet, but he was a mortal man whom we inspired. Hence, you tell the deniers of the truth, that is, he's addressing Mushrikun of Makkah. You tell them that if you do not know this, ask the followers of earlier revelation, Ahle Kitab. The followers of earlier revelation, Allah is referring to the Ahle Kitab, the Jews in Medina, and Christians living there. And Allah is addressing these Mushrikeen of Makkah. If they don't believe you, ask them to go and ask these Ahle Kitab that I sent prophets to them too, so why they are just denying this truth again? Allah is here elevating the status of Ahle Kitab, in other words, the respect which is necessary to be given to the followers of these earlier prophets if they follow the true monotheistic religion the way it came. To the point that Allah revealed the ayah telling the prophet to address the kuffar of Makkah that why they are denying while it's the same message. Go and ask these followers of earlier religion who are still in Medina. And Prophet himself, when he moved to Medina, gave the utmost respect to Ahle Kitab and he stayed there despite all their shortcomings, which is a different topic. And yes, there were differences, and later in Medina life of Prophet, things happened which shouldn't have happened amongst Muslims and Jews and Christians there. All of these Prophets were inspired by and preached the same fundamental truths. The principle of oneness ought to be reflected in the unity of all who believe in Him, although specific laws, surely they differ based on the time and the social development of the followers. Quran is full of stories of prophets and how they brought the message to people of their time. One would ask why Allah has to share all of these stories through Prophet Muhammad to humans since end of the time, to us. And the answer Allah gives in Surah Hud, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَكُلًّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبِيَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَجَاءَكَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَقُّ وَمَوْعِظَةً وَذِكْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. All that we relate to you of these stories of messenger, Allah provides a reason why, so that we can strengthen your heart, O Prophet. For through these truth comes to you as well as counsel and a message and a remembrance to those who have faith. So whenever Quran relates the stories of earlier prophets or ancient legends or their followers, the nations, the aim is invariably a moral lesson. Quran actually often reverts again and again to the same stories, but every time with a slight variation of stress, Allah offers the humankind this great historic information to guide and to make their hearts stronger, just like He made Prophet's heart stronger by these stories relating to prior prophets and prior nations. Allah sent thousands of prophets, and although the message of all prophets was the same, not all attained the same degree in the eye of Allah. We know Quran only mentions 27 of them, and these were all given the higher status. And some of us said, they were given higher status, and that's why they were mentioned in Quran by name too. But Allah also says in Surah Az-Zukhruf, وَرَفَعْنَا بَعْضُهُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَةً, and we raised some of them several degrees above the others, especially the five great prophets of Islam known as Ulul Azam, as Quran describes in Surah Shu'ara, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, شَرَعَ لَكُم مِّنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى أَن أَقِيمُوا الدِّينَ وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا. Allah has ordained for you the same religion which He ordained for Noah. So He mentions Noah's name, alayhi salam. And which we have revealed to you, O Muhammad. So Muhammad's name comes in this ayah. And that which we ordained for Ibrahim, Musa, and Isa. So three other names come. And these five messengers are known as Ulul Azm. Saying you should establish religion and make no division in it. When he says religion, it's religion of Islam given to all these five prophets. So this is a commandment of Allah which is given to Prophet ﷺ, that make no difference between what these earlier prophets have brought. Prophet Ibrahim ﷺ was called Khalif, the intimate of friend of Allah, because he had attained the degree by embracing the height of patience, resolve, and unshakable belief in Allah's Qadr that no other prophet has achieved. He traveled far and wide to spread Tawheed and fight paganism of his time. Musa alayhi salam was given title of Kalimullah. He could speak to Allah. He gave the Torah to his followers. Although he miraculously helped them and saved his nation from tyrant Pharaoh, many of them rejected his message. In Surah Ali Imran, verse 50, Allah mentions about Prophet Isa then, who is bringing the same message which Prophet Musa brought. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَمُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ مِنَ التَّوْرَاتِ وَلِأُهِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْدَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَجِئْتُكُمْ بِآيَاتٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُونِ. And I have come to confirm the truth. So Prophet Isa is saying to Bani Israel, I have come to confirm the truth, whatever there still remains of Torah, and to make lawful unto you some of the things which were forbidden to you. So he's bringing some ease to the religion for Bani Israel compared to what Prophet Musa brought. And then ayah goes on, and I have come to you with a proof from your Lord, so have taqwa of Allah and obey me. So therefore Prophet Isa spread the same message, same commandments which Prophet Musa brought, implementing the same divine laws according to his times. And then came seal of the Prophet ﷺ, Muhammad, who was given this divine law, Quran, which is now applicable to all times till the day of judgment, completing the deen Allah and his commandments, to lead his people, nation, out of darkness into the light. But despite all of these different degrees that prophets received and different commandments and laws of their time, what Allah commands us, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَهَدٍ مِنْ رُسُلٍ, make no distinction between any of my prophets. Allah may give higher status to whomever He wills. Whatever higher status He gave to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ or these Ulul Azm five prophets, that's His thing. But He commands us what? لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَهَدٍ مِنْ رُسُلٍ, make no distinction. And this commandment is one of the supreme commandments of Allah, not to differentiate any of his messenger. And this why a supreme commandment? Because this is part of the ayah which Allah gave Prophet ﷺ during Mi'raj, the last two ayah of Surah Baqarah. And this is the ayah, Amanur Rasul bima unzila ilayhi min rabbihi wal mu'minun kullun amana billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusuli. And then he says, la nufarriqu bayna ahadin min rusuli wa qalu sami'na wa ata'na wa ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir. Let's come down to the second part of the ayah which I earlier shared. فَتَكَتَّعُوا أَمْرَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ زُبْرٌ كُلُّ حِزْبٍ لِمَا لَدَيْهُمْ فَرِحُونَ. So Allah's message was, don't differentiate. For what did followers did? They have torn their unit wide asunder, piece by piece, each group delighting in what they themselves possess. Allah mentions this again in Surah Al-Anbiya. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إِنَّ هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونِ وَاتَّقَطَّعُوا أَمْرَهُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ كُلٌّ إِلَيْنَا رَاجِعُونَ. Verily, all who believe in me, so he's talking to the faithful, not even kuffar, this community of yours is one single community. Since I am sustainer of you all, worship then me alone. But then he refers to them, but they have broken up, differed in their religion among themselves, and they shall all return to us. So this is what followers of these prophets did. Forget about respecting different prophetic teachings and their followers. People made so many sects within the followers of the same prophet. The well-authenticated saying of prophet quoted by Imam Ibn Hanbal, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Prophet ﷺ says, the Jews have been split into 71 sects and the Christians into 72 sects. And he is predicting, my community will split into 73 sects. In classic Arabic use of this number 70 means many. And it doesn't mean exactly 71, 72, 73. But Prophet is emphasizing that division of among the Muslims will be much more than what Jews and Christians of his time had. And that's true. Did it happen? Yes. Look at various sects of Jews, Christians, and look at state of Muslim Ummah. You realize in no time that Allah had given our Prophet the knowledge of future state. And this is one of the miracle and proof of his prophethood, that whatever he said is true now. But what are the solutions then? Same which Prophet himself, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, practiced while he was alive in Medina, for example. He respected his Ahlul Kitab neighbors. The same way we should deal with them. We should honor them as our neighbors while living among them, especially in countries in like US and Western countries. Especially in this day and age of rhetoric we have for Muslims, where many of these Christians and Jews are our supporters actually. Remember, when there was extreme opposition of Muslims in Makkah, where did Prophet send them to their protection? Where did the first hijrah took place? To the Christian land, where the King Najashi gave protection to these Meccan refugees. Allah repeatedly consoles our Prophet when he was facing these trials by mentioning stories of these earlier prophets and nations. The prophet whose name is most mentioned in Quran is what? Whose? Prophet Musa alayhi salam, with his nation's trial in the Quran. And they had to go through massive trials. And Allah knew about it. And what did Allah ask Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam to make dua for? رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِسْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا. Our Lord, laid not on us a burden like that which you did lay on those before us. That is Ahlul Kitab. They had to go through much more burden than us with the blessing of Prophet ﷺ. We did not have to go through. Imagine the Jewish faith, despite these many trials and tribulations of almost 3,000 years since Pharaoh's time. There are many of them still holding on to their faith, maybe in a twisted way, but mostly in the same way as it came, in a monotheistic way. Yes, with their shortcoming. Just like we have shortcoming in Muslims. And the same cases with Christians. Yes, with their shortcomings, their guiding principles and ethics are mostly the same. I'm going to share with you a very sacred Jewish-Christian document, and everybody knows about this, called Ten Commandments. And what are these Ten Commandments which they believe in? I am your Lord, your God. You shall have no other gods besides me. And while I'm saying, just remember what Islam says about this, anything different that we know. You shall not make yourself any image of God or take any other name besides God. Remember the Sabbath day, and we have our Friday. Allah talks about Friday repeatedly in Quran. Honor your father and mother. Don't kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. Don't bear false witness. And don't harm your neighbor. So these are their Ten Commandments which they follow, and that's what we follow in a Quranic way, in our own way. Yes, there are differences. Yes, there are shortcomings. But there are many, many common things that I mentioned. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.
Allah mentions in Surah in Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَكِنْ لَيَبْلَوَكُمْ فِي مَا آتَاكُمْ فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ فِيهِ تَخْتَلِفُونَ. If Allah had willed, He would have made you one nation. But that He may test you in what He has given you. So compete in good deeds. The return of you all is to Allah. Then He will inform you about that which you used to differ. Allah said, if I wanted to make human only one nation, I could have easily done that, but I made differences. And Allah will ask us what we used to do with these differences in our faith, differences in our nations. And when it comes to difference among Muslim Ummah, the solutions are also given by Quran and Prophet Sallallahu. Prophet Sallallahu said in one of the hadiths, authentic again, cohesion is mercy and isolation is torment. He always strove for cohesion, unity. When he went to Medina, the first thing he did was what? To build a mosque, masjid. Mosques are built so that people of a city or an area may gather in order for mercy, to benefit at a greater level than they could benefit at an individual level at their homes. Within 2 days, we are approaching month of Zilhajj. Why do you think Hajj was made obligatory? Visiting Kaaba was made compulsory, if we can. And the reason is obvious. So people from all of these cities and countries of the world, they get together there and they forget their differences and become united. There is a great wisdom and underlying reason for this performing Hajj. And the famous ayah in Surah Imran where Allah mentions, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَاتَسِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. And hold fast together unto the rope of Allah and do not draw apart from one another. And remember the blessings which Allah has bestowed upon you. How when you were enemies, He brought your hearts together so that through His blessing you became brethren. Allah is speaking to Mu'mineen here. And the rope here signifies the bond, the trust with Allah. And what is this trust? Ibn Kathir cites a hadith, authority of Ali radiallahu anhu, said, Prophet said, Quran is Allah's strong rope and straight way. And again, Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu anhu reports same thing. Surely this Quran is Allah's strong rope, a manifest light, a beneficial source of healing. It's a protection to those who hold fast to it and a means of salvation for those who abide by it. Through it, adversity became one in heart. Through revelation, we are not only offered inner peace on individual level, but when the divine principles mentioned in Quran were practiced in the society, people became brethren. True well-being came for the societies. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, these accounts of prophets tell us that life doesn't come easy. Hardship, tribulations are essential ingredients of human endeavor in this world, especially for the faithful. These trials that Prophet had to undergo were part of their training. It enhanced their strength. And just like Prophets who preserved and resorted to Allah's help, and they are bound to receive Allah's help, we are also bound to receive that help if we also do the same, make tawbah, and hold on to the rope of Allah. We end with the same prayer which Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam prayed, asking for repentance from Allah when they were raising the foundation of temple, the Kaaba. They prayed, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, رَبَّنَا وَجَعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Our Lord, and make us submissive unto You and of our offsprings, a nation submissive unto You, and show us our manasik, our ceremonies, and accept our repentance. Truly, You are the one who accepts repentance, the most merciful. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ
Let us please.